Oh, very young, what will you leave us this time? You're only dancing on this earth for a short while. And though your dreams may toss and turn you now, they will vanish away like your dad's best jeans, denim blue, fading up to the sky. And though you want them to last forever, you know we never will. You know we never will.
Good.
Thank you.
And the patches make the goodbye harder still.
Here we are with Joe Potosi. He is the writer of this book, When the Dust Settled. Joe, what inspired you to write this book?
Very good question, sir. I'd have to say that what inspired me to write the book was my desire to help other people. Other people who have been through a rough childhood, such as myself, but they're still struggling. They're still in the shadows. They're carrying around unforgiveness or hatred in their heart for maybe what people have done or said to them in the past. And this whole book, it started off as a journal. When I found out I was going to become a father, I started journaling things down after I would have dreams and nightmares of what I endured as a child myself. And what I discovered was by journaling these facts, these histories, it gave me a peace. It gave me a sense of closure, a sense of healing. My wife, who was an avid reader herself, would read my journal or have me read it to her out loud, and she recommended I write a book with the intention of this book helping people. And that's been my motivation this whole time, this whole process. It's taken me well over 10 years for one reason or another, setbacks, surgeries, whatever the case is. But I decided I have to get my story out. Now, let's suppose you have a similar story. I'm not in any way suggesting my story is worse than yours. Again, what I'm suggesting is you can find that forgiveness in your heart for people. You can find love for those who wronged you. And you need to let go.
Very good. Joe, I was wondering if you could kind of tell us your history. What's the book about? Where does it start off in your life? And maybe you could elaborate a little on the hardships that you had during your childhood.
Certainly. So the book takes place in Rockford, Illinois. When I was 3 years old, we moved into the housing projects in Rockford, Jen Adams. And we were a family of five, my mother, father, older sister, and my baby brother. And my mother was pregnant with my brother, Greg. If someone says, describe your family at that point, we were dirt poor. We lived in a real dump, and we got accepted into the housing projects, which was like on that show, The Jeffersons, moving on up, right? For us, it was moving on up. But within a short period of time, the relationship between my dad and my mother deteriorated rather quickly. This man named Tyrone befriended my dad, I discovered later, to just get to my mom. The drinking of alcohol and smoking of weed, etc., became an everyday occurrence. Before long, my dad left. And this man, Tyrone, became my stepfather. And the family that was once described as a loving, caring, nurturing family was now one that I endured physical abuse on a daily, verbal abuse, mental abuse, for nearly 15 years. And I remember my stepdad never worked, but he always promised to get us out of the projects. Well, eventually we did get out of the projects, and we moved to the west side of Rockford, but nothing changed with the dynamics. You have to understand, my sister and myself knew who my dad was. I remember the day he left, like yesterday. And I wanted that back. Because having that back meant our family, our nuclear family is together as it once was. I used to daydream about my dad just showing up around the next corner and rescuing us, setting us free from this horrible life that in which we were living. And my younger brothers didn't know anyone but my stepdad as their father. And almost on a daily basis, I was reminded of how much I was like my dad and how much I was hated by my mother and my stepdad. I talked like my dad, I acted like my dad, and they took it out on me. One of my stepdad's favorite things to do was, he was a big boxing fan, Muhammad Ali. I liked Ali too, but if Ali was fighting someone like George Foreman or Frazier, I would go with the person that was fighting Ali. That was a representation of me against him. He would put on a boxing clinic for my brothers, and he would punch me in my chest. He had me take off my shirt, punch me in my chest, and then he demanded I punch him back. Now, he's 6'5", 350, right? And, of course, I'm terrified. He's an intimidating individual. And I'll punch him back, and he would ridicule me for, that's just a slap, you need a punch. And this will go on, this pattern. I when I was in elementary school, I picked up a paper route to help the family, to make money, to help my mom pay bills. I did that for nearly a year, and through that paper route job, I got a job snow shoveling. I don't know if you remember the blizzard of 79, all that snow we got. I made a bunch of money. But unfortunately, they took it from me for the most part. And I decided that's enough. He doesn't even work. He drinks a fifth of brandy every day, E&J brandy, gets weed, does what he does. My mom works, but when she's not working, she's getting smashed, right? I decided to quit the paper route. That's it. And that following Saturday, I wake up to the sound of the Temptations. Papa Was a Rolling Stone, just blaring. I go upstairs and ask my stepdad to turn it down, where I noticed him at the kitchen table, furiously cleaning his .38 caliber handgun. He orders me to have a seat at the kitchen table, goes into the living room, turns off the stereo, comes back, and proceeds to ask me why I quit the paper route. And at this time, I'm looking down because I'm afraid. And I can hear him, you know, working on the gun, and I can hear him putting bullets back in it. And I heard the click. He closed the cylinder, and he goes, hey. I looked up at him. He goes, give me one reason why I shouldn't pull the trigger. Click. Instantly, I peed my pants, ran downstairs, and hid behind a furnace where I knew he couldn't get me. Now, I was walking on eggshells for years before this, but I was most definitely really walking on eggshells from that point forward. Okay, listen. When I was a child, I was so depressed. I looked for my stepdad's guns. I wanted to kill myself. And a light came on and it said, you know what? I got to be here for my brothers. They're counting on me. And that thought never came back. Listen, maybe you've been through a very, very tough situation yourself. But you feel like you're insignificant. You're not worthy. You're a piece of garbage. You're not worth the ground you're standing on, because that's what you've been always taught. So at a certain point, you believe that. I'm here to tell you that you are significant, that you do have value, that you have a role in this world in which we live. And if you have unforgiveness for someone, even if that someone is now deceased, you need to let that go. Because I can promise you, you'll experience something you never experienced before. You know, I talked about this before in a different, with somebody else. My stepfather, we left him in 1982, long time. I moved to Dubuque in 94, right? He was in Madison from all those years. He was still renting space in my brain. He still had power over me. I say, how could that be? Because I allowed it. Because I had unresolved anger, resentment, unforgiveness. It was destroying me on the inside. And I just want to encourage you that, you know, maybe it is you got to talk to somebody. Maybe it's counseling. Don't be embarrassed. Don't be ashamed. And if you are a parent, if you are a mother or a father, think of the kids. What legacy are we going to leave our kids? When I'm dead and gone, when they say the dash, 19 so-and-so till 20 whatever, I don't want that dash to represent not just the fact that I was a son and a brother, but a husband and a father, a great father who did his best and gave back to the community. And regardless of what people may say, at the end of the day, it's what God says and what my relationship with him that matters. So don't give up. Don't quit. Thank you.
Talking.
I wanted to say that this book has been my life's work. It's been a desire of mine to share my story and to be transparent and to be honest and to be as truthful about everything possible. What's unique about this book, however, is that it was a family project. My sister, Toots, did the artwork, the cover for the book. My brother Marty wrote the foreword. And my brother Greg, I attribute the title to him. He mentioned the title When the Dust Settled many years ago when he wrote me a letter about all the stuff that we endured together, but when the dust settled, I was still standing. We were still standing. So this book has so much value to me than words can express. And it's my hope and desire, as you read this book and after you finish this book, that you are inspired, you are encouraged, and you will be a better person because of this book. You will see the role that God plays in your life and the importance of family, the importance of love, honesty, and integrity. Thank you. May God bless.
Oh, very young, what will you leave us this time? You're only dancing on this earth for a short while. And though your dreams may toss and turn you now, they will vanish away like your daddy's best jeans, denim blue, fading up to the sky. And though you want them to last forever, you know we never will. You know we never will. And the patches make the goodbye harder still.